1 Corinthians 13, let's read it once more, get the context, everything that's taking place. Paul says, verse 1, "If I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, but do not have love, I've become a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and know all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. And if I give all my possessions to feed the poor, and if I surrender my body to be burned, but do not have love, it profits me nothing. Love is patient, love is kind, and is not jealous. Love does not brag and is not arrogant, does not act unbecomingly. It does not seek its own, is not provoked, does not take into account a wrong suffered, does not rejoice in unrighteousness, but rejoices with the truth. Bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails. But if there are gifts of prophecy, they will be done away. If there are tongues, they will cease. If there is knowledge, it will be done away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part. But when the perfect comes, the partial will be done away. When I was a child, I used to speak like a child, think like a child, reason like a child. When I became a man, I did away with such childish things. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I will know fully, just as I also have been fully known. But now faith, hope, love abide, these three. But the greatest of these is love." Like I said, our study of 1 Corinthians now leads us into a different direction, different emphasis this morning. As you all know, we've spent the vast majority of our time of this chapter on the characteristics of love as we have just simply slowly plotted through verses 4 through 7. But now that we're coming to a point where we're actually saying goodbye to those verses, to those characteristics, and actually welcoming this next section in verses 8 through 13. We're still on the topic of love, but no longer are we going to have the exhortation from the Apostle Paul about what love does. Rather, our attention will be devoted to the topic of how long does love last? How long will it last? If you remember correctly, we first started our exposition on 1 Corinthians 13. When we started it, we came to a section of Scripture that almost seemed like it didn't really fit in with the overall context. And the reason why I say that is because the chapter before chapter 13, obviously 12, and the chapter after chapter 13, 14, are both dealing with the topic of spiritual gifts. So you have this chapter highlighting the topic of love that is sandwiched between two chapters that are dealing with spiritual gifts. And if you were to quickly glance over these three chapters, it could cause you to sit back and say to yourself or think to yourself, how does this all really fit together? Was Paul just tired of talking about the spiritual gifts and he needed a little bit of a break, so he had to talk about something more sentimental like love? No, that's not what Paul's doing. Even though chapter 13 is somewhat of a rabbit trail for Paul, and it is most certainly a divinely inspired rabbit trail, a rabbit trail that only strengthens his argument about spiritual gifts. Now, what I want to do, I just want to cement in your minds where we've been, because we were so focused on the details of verses 4 through 7. I want to cement in our minds, and we've talked about this before, but the purpose of chapter 13 and why it sits in the middle of these two other chapters just on the discussion of spiritual gifts. We'll just bring everything together to see how Paul is thinking about this, and I think this is going to be important for our argument on 8 through 13. But we must remember that Paul began his instruction about spiritual gifts in chapter 12 because this was one of the hot button issues in the church at Corinth. This was a problematic area for the church, just like everything else seemed to be. But chapter 12 was written because the Corinthians had a massive problem exercising spiritual gifts in a manner that was according to orderly worship and in a manner that was Christ-like in its character. They had wrong views about certain spiritual gifts and were mistaken about the value of all the gifts. They were even prone to elevate one gift over another. Particularly, they loved the gift of tongues. some things never change in our day and age. That seems to be one of the spiritual gifts that some people think are still around, and that's the one that is emphasized. You need to be speak in tongues if you're going to be a believer. We see that emphasis in some of our modern day churches of our generation. So chapter 12 is just one big corrective lesson on spiritual gifts. I view chapter 12 as Paul's opportunity to be like a father who's really sitting down his children and telling them to stop playing with their spiritual toys in the wrong way. They were abusing their spiritual gifts, quote-unquote spiritual toys, like immature children do. Abusing them or using them selfishly, like immature children do. They were viewing them wrongly, like immature children do. One spiritual toy was not necessarily greater than another, and everybody didn't need to have the same one. So they could just stop the bickering, stop the fighting, stop the arguing, stop thinking that you're better than others just because you have something, a gift, that someone else doesn't have. So what does Paul do? Well, in chapter 12, verse 4, verse 7, verse 11, he explains the source of the spiritual gifts, the Holy Spirit. You Corinthians can't take any credit for the gifts you have. They all came from the third person of the Trinity. In verses 4, 5, and 6 of chapter 12, Paul even makes it a point to stress how there's not just one kind of gift in the church, but varieties of gifts, verse 4, and how those various gifts can be used in various ways and opportunities, verse 5, and how they can be energized by God to produce various effects and fruits, verse 6. So essentially he's saying, you Corinthians shouldn't be elevating one gift over another, propping one up on a pedestal, and diminishing another to the level of insignificance. On top of that, Paul speaks about the purpose of the spiritual gifts, how they're for the common good, the edification of the church, chapter 12, verse 7. And then he doesn't stop there. Verses 8 through 10, he informs the Corinthians about some of the gifts that were prevalent and noticeable and evident in their church. His emphasis was to show them every single one of the gifts, that they were diverse and that they were supplied by the Holy Spirit so that no man could boast. And that was another problem, boasting in their spiritual gifts. And then from there, Paul puts forth a fitting, marvelous analogy of the human body in verses 12 through 31, really 12 through 27, to show that unity will and can exist with all diversity. All the different gifts in the church will work together in perfect harmony for the edification of the church, just as the different parts of the human body will work together in perfect harmony for the growth and betterment of the body. Wonderful analogy, and really an illustration that would have been a rebuke to the Corinthians because they were more functioning like a human body with an autoimmune disease attacking itself, rather than like a human body that was always working together to help and heal all the other parts. They were destroying the body. They weren't building it up. So once Paul makes his opening remarks and lays the groundwork on spiritual gifts, he gets to the end of chapter 12 and he says, you know what? Before I go on to talk about a more specific issue, this issue of tongues, prophecy, which is in chapter 14, but before I go on to talk about the issues revolving around those spiritual gifts, let me just hit the brakes for a moment. Let me just introduce a godly virtue that has massive implications on the way you use spiritual gifts. Let me introduce to you love. It's important. We need to talk about love. You Corinthians need to learn about love. Love is an important piece to the puzzle of spiritual gift. Love matters in this entire discussion. So between chapter 12 and chapter 14, you have this chapter on love. A rabbit trail, divinely inspired rabbit trail, but a needful rabbit trail. Paul wants to show the Corinthians that they are completely overlooking the bigger picture of what should drive and motivate and compel the exercise of spiritual gifts. Love. That's what stands behind the gifts that we use in the church. There is a more excellent way worth pursuing than just eagerly and sinfully desiring the next so-called greater spiritual gift. And that's exactly how Paul ends chapter 12. Church life, body life is not about chasing the greater gifts. There's something far greater that should characterize the church. The church is not just characterized by gifted individuals. The church is characterized by gifted individuals who know how to exercise those gifts in love. So Paul makes a beeline to talk about love. It's the very thing that must be running alongside of spiritual gifts in the church. And that's how this chapter of love goes hand in hand with Paul's argument about spiritual gifts. Now, originally, 10 lessons ago, I framed up an outline for chapter 13, and this was how I broke it down. I said that in 1 Corinthians 13, 1 through 13, this entire chapter, Paul expounds on the more excellent way, which he says in chapter 12, verse 31, the end of chapter 12, Paul expounds on the more excellent way of love by making three crucial points. The first crucial point was the priority of love in verses 1 through 3, which we already covered. You can go back, listen to the message if you want. We're not going to go over it. But there's a preeminent position that love holds. It's a priority when spiritual gifts are being exercised. The second crucial point that Paul was expounding on was the practice of love in verses 4 through 7. And we brought that section to a close last week. 15 glorious characteristics, verbs of love, of what love does, and what God-like love does not do. And then the third crucial point, which we'll be looking at today, is the permanence of love. So you had the priority of love in verses 1 through 3, the practice of love in verses 4 through 7, and now today, the permanence of love in verses 8 through 13. How long will love last compared to the gifts in the church? How long will love be needful and necessary for this life and the life to come? I mean, Paul will even make a case of how long love will last versus faith and hope. And in this section that we have now, the permanence of love, this is where we're going to be spending the rest of our time. So, verse 8. I love how Paul kicks off this section in verse 8 for the permanence of love. He doesn't leave us in suspense, that's for sure. He doesn't leave us guessing. He lets us know right off the bat about the permanent nature of love by saying, love never fails. Love never fails. Paul doesn't want to just let us know that love shouldn't be prioritized only, verses 1 through 3, or that love must be practiced, verses 4 through 7, but that the priority of love and the practice of love will never come to an end. It's the capstone of this entire section. And just to be sure that we don't miss the point of verses 8 through 13, Paul will begin his argument by stressing the permanence of love in verse 8, and he'll end his argument by highlighting the permanence of love in verse 13. There's bookends here. Watch how he does this. In verse 8, he says, love never fails. Obviously, that's a reference to the perpetual continuation of love. And then in verse 13, he says, faith, hope, and love abide. In other words, these continue on. These are remaining as well. Abide these three, but the greatest of these three is love. The entire point of these six verses is that love does not cease. I don't want you to miss that because I'm going to get into some information later that we could get lost, but that's the point. Love does not cease. But as we'll come to find out, the things that sit in between these two statements about love, those things will come to an end. Those things will come to an end. They will cease. They will have a conclusion that Paul is comparing love to. Now, I'm not going to jump ahead of myself here because I want to spend some time on the opening phrase in verse 8. Why? Because this is such a profound reality for what we have to look forward to as Christians. I mean, just this phrase that Paul opens with, it's not only something that we can look forward to now and experience now, but also something that we can expect to enjoy forever. I don't want to just breeze right by this profound reality without giving it some weighty thought. So let's just spend a bit of a time on the opening remarks of verse 8. When Paul says love never fails, the translation fails is probably not the best translation. I mean, it works, but it's probably not the best translation, which is so interesting because the vast majority of English translations translate it this way. There are a few translations, like if you have the ESV, that say love never ends, which isn't a bad translation, but most translations are going to read love never fails. The word fails, in the original language, is pipto. Literally means to fall or to fall down. Now listen to this. Out of the 90 times that this word is used in the New Testament, only twice is it translated as fail. Here in verse 8 and Luke 16, 17. But almost every other time in the New Testament, it's translated as fall or fallen or fall down or falling or even fell, past tense. The word means to move rapidly in a downward direction. Let me give you a few examples. For example, you see this word used of Eutychus in Acts 20, verse 9. Do you all remember who Eutychus was? He was the guy who was sitting on the windowsill, sinking into a deep, deep sleep as Paul kept talking and talking and talking, kind of like what we do from this pulpit, and talking throughout the night. And he was overcome with sleep. He was overcome with sleep, and then listen to this. And he fell down from the third floor and was picked up dead. He fell to the point of death. Same word that Paul's using here, chapter 13, verse 8. Another example would be Acts 15, 16. There you have a reference to the tabernacle of David. And it says about the tabernacle of David that it has fallen. In other words, it was destroyed. It was left to ruins. There was nothing left. There was no existence any longer. Another example would be 1 Corinthians 10:8, where Paul uses this word. Paul's speaking about Israel when they were in the wilderness, and because of their immorality, 23,000 of them fell in one day. In other words, they were wiped off the face of the earth. Their physical lives ended. They ceased to be. That's the idea that stands behind this word. So when Paul says here, and this is awesome to me, when Paul says here in verse 8 that love never falls, he's saying essentially that love does not die, ever. Love will never be destroyed, ever. Love will not be brought to ruins. Love will never be wiped off the face of the earth. As a matter of fact, not only will love not ever be removed from the face of the earth, it'll never be removed from any realm of existence, not the physical realm that we live in or the spiritual realm that God inhabits. Love never ends. Love does not cease. There's an unending, perpetual nature about love. It's indestructible. Beloved, indestructible. There's an eternal time frame that is associated with love. Do we understand that love was not something that God simply created for this temporal world only? 1 John 4:8, what's it teach? You probably know it. It teaches us that God is love, right? Love goes on forever because God goes on forever. For as long as God has been around, love has existed as well. And because God has always been self-existent, having no beginning or no end, so has love always been alive and active as well. I mean, give some deep thought to this because this reality is astonishing to us. I was driving over here thinking, I'm not just going to experience your love right now and am experiencing love right now. I will never stop experiencing your love for all eternity. I mean, can you even begin to wrap your mind around the fact that the heavenly home that awaits all of us who are in union with Jesus Christ will be in a place of unending love? Let me just try to put this thought in perspective. Compare love to the other things that Christians experience now. There are other virtues that we experience, other duties, other obligations, other privileges, other blessings that we do now that will not go on forever. And they are marvelous Christian experiences, joys, But some of the things we do now will not continue throughout eternity. For instance, evangelism. Evangelism will not be a Christian responsibility in heaven. Why? Because everyone in heaven has already been evangelized and they've responded to the gospel rightly. Repentance. Repentance is not something that will go on forever. It will not be in heaven either. The great Christian experience and joy of turning away from sin will not be needed because heaven is a place of sinless saints and angels. What do you need to repent of when you're sinlessly perfect? Faith will not go on forever, as we'll see in a little bit. The faith we practice and apply will give way to sight. We will finally have in person what our faith once rested in, Jesus Christ. We'll see him for as he is. Hope will not go on forever. Hope will be realized. It will give way to fruition. There's no need for hope when you have the full consummation of all that you once longed for. There's no hope in heaven. It ends. So those are some of the things that will not reach the shores of that heavenly home. But love? Love does not only transcend every shore on this planet. Love has not only been ever present in eternity past, but love will be waiting for our arrival in glory, and it will be like a ceaseless chaperone for our souls as we walk among the new heavens and a new earth. It's awesome to think about. Our heavenly home will have an atmosphere of love. Love will penetrate and simply permeate every person, place, and thing. I will love everyone in heaven perfectly, forever. You will love everyone in heaven perfectly, forever. We all together will love God in heaven perfectly, forever. Love's perfect abilities and expressions will never diminish, never grow weary, never fade, never end. Paul says love never fails. Better yet, Paul says love never falls, not in the slightest degree. And as he establishes that profound reality, because as he moves forward into the following verses, he will contrast love's permanence, as what we just saw, with something else that does not last forever, namely spiritual gifts, certain spiritual gifts. Look at what Paul says again in verse 8. Love never fails, but here's Paul's contrast. What he's saying, unlike love, here's something that does fall. Here's something that does cease. Here's something that does come to an end. But if there are gifts of prophecy, they will be done away. If there are tongues, they will cease. If there is knowledge, it will be done away. Prophecy, tongues, knowledge, these were the gifts most prevalent, most prioritized in the Corinthian church. And Paul says each of these, at some point, each of these are going to come to an end, unlike love. Now, just so we're clear, Paul's focusing his attention on a few of the revelatory gifts, the miraculous gifts, sign gifts, supernatural gifts, even though every spiritual gift are supernatural. But these particular gifts seem to have gotten more attention than all the rest in Corinth. Most of the problems in Corinth probably revolved around the gifts of prophecy, tongues, and knowledge in this specific area. Why? Because these were the wow gifts. These were the recognizable gifts. These were the gifts that elevated you, or some people did elevate. These were the gifts that somehow got elevated above all the rest. But just so we're clear, because I'm moving in a direction, but just so we're clear, when Paul speaks of prophecy in verse 8, he's referring to, like I said, a revelatory gift. In other words, he's referring to a gift that reveals God's message as God intended. As MacArthur has said, he gives a good definition of prophecy. Prophecy is always presented as the infallible, authoritative declaration of God's inerrant revelation. It was a verbal declaration using words the prophet vocalized audibly or wrote legibly in the presence of others who could hear or read them. That's prophecy, God's direct revelation to his messengers. When Paul speaks about tongues in verse 8, again, you could put this in probably a couple different categories, but he's referring to another revelatory gift. But this particular gift was a gift used to communicate the revelation of God and the gospel in another known language. Not a language that was learned, but it was a language that was gifted to a person so that they could communicate the gospel or truth. And then when Paul speaks about knowledge in verse 8, he again is referring to a revelatory gift. This isn't, Paul's not talking about general knowledge here. That's not what Paul's talking about. He's talking about something vastly different. It was a gift, and if you went back to chapter 12, verses 8 through 11, this gift is in there. It was a gift that allowed someone to have the revelation of the mind of God in doctrinal and redemptive areas. This was not learned or acquired like we learn or acquire knowledge right now. That's a completely different type of gift. And I preached a sermon on that in chapter 12 on verses 8 through 11, so you can listen to how I explained it there. But this is a divinely imparted gift of knowledge to someone. Very important for us to make these distinctions because Paul says that these revelatory gifts, these unique, spirit-empowered abilities, which were used for a specific time in redemptive history, will eventually be done away. They will cease. Paul's whole point is to tell the Corinthians, if you're going to invest in something, then invest in something that will never end. Invest in love. If you're going to invest in something, don't put so much stock in these temporary gifts because you Corinthians are going to see the end of them. Paul was reassuring the Corinthians that they could expect to see the end of these revelatory gifts, and the priority should have been more aimed at love. Don't sinfully admire something that is going to fall and fail and fade away. Don't overemphasize and overprioritize these needful gifts, but they are transient gifts. Don't overemphasize those above love. That's the contrast that Paul was making to the Corinthians. That's what he was making fully aware to them. I don't think that Paul ever would have made this contrast to the Corinthian church if these gifts were going to last and stick around for the duration of the church age, like so many people claim today. If these gifts were expected to stay with the Corinthian church, then Paul would have simply said, exercise these gifts because they're going to continue, but make sure that love always accompanies them. He doesn't say that. He says, love never ends, but these gifts will end, and you, Corinthians, will see them vanish right before your eyes. Now, granted, some people could die and move on, and they might not see them vanish before their eyes, but that's a whole other topic. But Paul's saying, give all your attention to how you demonstrate love toward one another while these gifts are still around. And when these revelatory gifts are gone, then you can still go on displaying love toward one another. Because love never fails, unlike these gifts. That's his point. Look at verse 8. Paul says, of prophecy, it will be done away. He says the same thing of knowledge in verse 8. It will be done away. It's the same verb in both cases. The verb is katargeo in the original language. It means to reduce to inactivity or to abolish, to pass away, to be rendered inoperative. Paul is saying the gift of prophecy and knowledge will be eliminated, abolished. The other interesting thing about this verb is that it's in the passive voice, which simply means that someone or something will cause these gifts to be abolished. And I think Paul's making a reference to God here because God is the true source of divine revelation. He gives it out as he so chooses. He's the only one who can fully abolish these gifts. So Paul's saying at some point God will abolish the gifts of prophecy and knowledge. Those gifts will serve their purpose for a time in redemptive history, in the church age. And when God decides to stop sending direct revelation to men, then these gifts will be rendered inoperative. Now for tongues, Paul uses the verb cease. It's a different verb than the ones that were used for prophecy and knowledge, but it simply means a similar thing. It means to stop. It means to come to an end. Paul's point's the same. Tongues will not continue either. Now, this is the question that you're probably thinking. I think I know the question that you're begging me to answer. You're sitting there thinking to yourself, Brian, can you give me a more specific time frame on when these gifts will stop, or better yet, have already stopped? Sure. Absolutely. I can give you that answer. As a matter of fact, I can give you an exact time when these gifts will stop, or should I say, have stopped. How's that for being precise on timing? Does that excite your heart? For those of you who just love the argument about spiritual gifts, sign gifts, when do they cease, when do they stop? You can't just wait to go tell your charismatic friends, I know the exact timing when these gifts have stopped. Here's my answer. You have to deal with it now. Well, it's not like it's a mystery. God hasn't left us in the dark. The answer is actually in the next two verses. Paul tells us plainly. Look at verses 9 and 10. Paul says, For we know in part, and we prophesy in part, but when the perfect comes, the partial will be done away. Do you want to know when the gifts are going to cease? When the perfect comes. That's Paul's answer. The partial gifts will be swallowed up by the quote-unquote perfect. That's your exact time frame. Now, you're probably sitting there thinking, that's not very helpful. What in the world does the word perfect mean? What is it referring to? And therein lies your problem. All kinds of debate about what the perfect refers to here. All kinds of debate. But here's the thing. If we figure out what Paul means, if we nail down what Paul specifically is referring to here, when he uses the word perfect, then we can be confident about when these gifts were abolished. All we have to do is figure out what Paul means by the word perfect, and we have an exact time of when these gifts ceased. Easy enough, right? Not so much. Now, before I get into this, let me just make one comment about verses 9 and 10, and listen carefully. These verses are very important to this entire argument. Verses 9 and 10 are Paul's explanation. Very important. Paul's explanation why the revelatory spiritual gifts of prophecy, knowledge, are temporary. In verse 9, Paul says, for. That's an explanatory gar in the Greek text. All that means is because. He's given us the reason. Why will these gifts that are mentioned in verse 8 be abolished? For, verse 9, or because, we know in part and we prophesy in part, but when the perfect comes, the partial will be done away. It's the reason for why these spiritual gifts are temporary. In other words, in verse 9, Paul is saying to the Corinthians, we have the gift of knowledge in part, partially, and we have the gift of prophecy in part, partially. But we don't have all of the divine revelation that we could have, that God intends for us to have. Verse 9 is simply saying about the Corinthians, to the Corinthians, we only know a fraction of what we're supposed to know, and we're currently only prophesying a fraction of what we're supposed to speak. But when the perfect comes, verse 10, these gifts that only allow us to communicate God's revelation in part, then they will be done away. In other words, listen, once the church of Jesus Christ has the complete knowledge of what the gift of knowledge was to teach, and when the church has the complete truth of what the gift of prophecy was to communicate, Once we have that complete divine revelation from God, then these gifts are going to be done away. We won't need them anymore. They're abolished. They're inoperative, rendered inoperative. We need to understand that the church didn't have all the knowledge and prophetic messages that God wanted them to have, like we have right now in the written word that we hold in our very hands. Paul was writing a letter, the other apostles were writing letters, collectively they were gathering these letters, but they didn't have all of these, all of the revelation from God that was complete yet. Verse 9, they only knew in part and prophesied in part. But as time went on, God was revealing more and more revelation through the apostles. And once the church had everything that God intended them to know, then the partial, revelatory gifts, prophecy, knowledge, tongues, etc., would be done away. Now, if you're tracking with me, or if you tracked with me through that argument, I kind of just gave you a hint about what I think the perfect refers to. But if I lost you through that wordy explanation on verses 9 and 10, hopefully it'll become more obvious as we continue. So let's just go back to the previous question that I had asked. What does Paul have in mind when he uses the word perfect in verse 10? Like I said before, if we figure out what the perfect is referring to, we have a definitive time frame on when these revelatory spiritual gifts have stopped. This is the fulcrum on which everything hinges. The entire debate about whether or not the miraculous gifts, the revelatory gifts, are still for today can simply come down, or at least one of the arguments can simply come down to how someone interprets the word perfect. But there's one sad reality that takes place among scholars, commentators in our evangelical era. There are so many scholars of our day who say that this very text, 1 Corinthians 13, 8 through 13, this very text cannot be used in the debate to determine when the miraculous gifts have ceased, which is absolutely insane. It's a text, it's a passage that specifically states the ceasing of these gifts. Why can't we use it? My old seminary professor has said this. He said, how can this passage not be used when the passage is about the passing away of three miraculous revelatory gifts and their contrast with the abiding of three Christian virtues, faith, hope, and love, in verse 13. I'm in full agreement with my seminary professor. I wholeheartedly agree that this passage should be used in the debate about when tongues, prophecy, knowledge have ceased. All we need to do is understand what Paul means by the word perfect. What does Paul have in mind when he uses the word perfect? Which, this is important too, the Greek word for perfect is teleos. I'm going to use that throughout this for the rest of the sermon, so just keep that in the back of your mind. The Greek word is teleos. Put on your thinking caps for about the next 15 minutes or so. And there's so much information on this that we could just talk, and I could bore you to death if I have not bored you to death already, but we could just have so much data dump on this whole information, but just engage with what I'm saying for now. And I think you'll be convinced about what the perfect refers to and when the miraculous gifts, prophecy, knowledge, tongues, have ceased. There are three primary views here. Three primary views about what the perfect means. And keep in mind, as we go through this, that the word perfect refers to, or can refer to, a different translation, mature. It has that meaning. It also can mean fully grown, it has that meaning. And teleos can also mean complete. That's going to be important to the discussion. So keep that in mind. The word perfect doesn't necessarily mean perfect. It could mean mature, it could mean fully grown, it could mean complete. So the first view, three primary views, here's the first one. Some would say that the perfect refers to the events at the eschaton. In other words, events that revolve around the end times. So they would say that the quote-unquote perfect teleos can refer to the second coming of Christ or the eternal state, i.e. heaven, or the eternal kingdom of God, which eagerly awaits us waiting for its arrival. And when this perfect state comes, the consummation of all these things, then the revelatory gifts will cease. That's one possibility, because the translation perfect quote unquote perfect, would fit this view because those events would bring about a perfect state. That's one possible view. And I'll just say right from the get-go, the vast majority of scholarly work, people take this view. They believe it has something to do with the return of Christ, the eternal state, something along those lines, revolving around the eschaton. But there's a second view. Others would say that the Greek word teleos refers to the maturity of the church or individual believers. When the church reaches full maturity, in one sense, then we can expect the miraculous sign gifts, the revelatory gifts, to cease. And again, this view again is possible because they argue for the meaning of the word teleos to mean mature. When the church matures, then, okay, the gifts are done. And then there's a third view where teleos refers to mature or the completed canon of Scripture. The completed canon of Scripture. The written works of the apostles, when they were all done, the finalized, that's what this would be referring to. The finished New Testament writings captured by the apostles and their immediate associates completed the partial revelatory gifts. Again, a viable option because, like I said, teleos can refer or mean complete. So there's the three debated views. From this point, I'm going to tell you where I land, why I land there. I totally disagree with the first view. The view that the vast majority of evangelicalism holds to, I totally disagree with that view. That the perfect teleos refers to the second coming of Christ, or the eternal state, or the consummation of all things, eschatological events. Why do I disagree with this view? Well, one reason is because the word teleos, which is translated perfect here in our English Bibles, is not the best translation for this context. Paul's not talking about something that is perfect in the way that we understand perfect. Paul is talking about something that is moving from a point of immaturity or incompleteness to a point of maturity and completeness. The illustration Paul uses in verse 11 confirms this. Look at the illustration in verse 11. When I was a child, I used to speak like a child, think like a child, reason like a child. When I became a man, I did away with childish things. Paul's clearly referring to how something or someone, a child in this illustration, grows and matures into a full-grown man, a complete man. So Paul doesn't have in mind a perfect state like the second coming of Christ, the eternal state, consummation of all things. The illustration is about a child who is incomplete in his speaking, thinking, reasoning, and how that child grows into a mature, complete man in his thinking, speaking, and reasoning. Another reason why I don't think Paul has eschatological events in mind is because those topics aren't even remotely part of this context. There's nothing in this context that's talking about the second coming of Christ. There's nothing in this context that talks about the eternal kingdom coming to be. Nothing here. It just doesn't fit. Another reason we shouldn't understand the perfect to refer to the perfect eternal state and all those other things, which will usher us into perfection, is because of how Paul uses the word teleos in his other writings. Listen, 6 out of the 7 times that Paul uses this word teleos, he is referring almost exclusively to something that is maturing or something that is growing to a state of completeness. So Paul doesn't even use this word this way, perfect, in his other writings. As a matter of fact, of all the 19 usages of this word teleos in the New Testament, there is not one use of that word that ever refers to the second coming of Christ or the millennium or the eternal state. So again, Paul's not referring to something that has to be perfect in order for these gifts to cease. I think he's referring to something that just needs to be complete, which would offset the partial, the temporary revelatory gifts in verse 9. He's just making the contrast. This is what's partial, and we're looking for something that is going to be complete. Not perfect, not the eternal state, not what Paul has in mind. One final reason why I believe that teleos, perfect, cannot refer to eschatological events. And it's because of the contrast that Paul makes in this section. Track with me on this argument. This seems to be the final nail in the coffin on this view. It just seems like a closed door, a shut case. Paul contrasts love with the miraculous gifts, the revelatory gifts, in verse 8. Love never ends, but these gifts will end. But then when you go down to verse 13, Paul says, but now faith, hope, and love abide these three, but the greatest of these is love. Paul now contrasts the miraculous gifts with the three things that will continue to abide: faith, hope, and love. Faith, hope, and love are abiding entirely through this entire life. But guess what? Faith and hope are not going on into eternity. They're going to cease at the return of Christ. So all that means is that the gifts, the revelatory gifts, must cease before faith and hope cease. If faith and hope are done at the second coming of Christ, the revelatory gifts have to stop somewhere well before that. Therefore, it's impossible for teleos to refer to an eschatological perfect event. So those are some of the reasons why I reject the first view. These other views will go somewhat quicker. I also disagree with the second view that teleos, perfect, in verse 10, refers to the maturity of the church or individual believers. People who take this view just say that at the completion of the New Testament canon, that God gave to the church, there was this one body of truth which enabled individual congregations to make decisions independently of the apostolic group, and those revelatory gifts at that point would cease. I don't believe you can prove this from this view from this passage either. It seems to be very subjective about, you know, who's to say when the church is going to be quote-unquote mature? In the fullest and final and greatest sense, the church is not fully mature until we stand with Christ in glory, the return of Christ, when we're enjoying our perfected state as sinless saints. That's when we're fully mature. Just because we have all the writings of the apostles doesn't mean that the church is mature at that point. We're growing in our maturity, but it's not complete like the word teleos is talking about. I mean, just look at the church right now. It's anything but mature. On top of that, the immediate context doesn't even allow for this, for us to take this view. Paul's not talking about the maturity of the church. He's talking about the gifts of prophecy and knowledge being partial in what they can provide for the church. And there will be a time when the gifts of knowledge and prophecy won't be needed because we will have the complete amount of knowledge and complete amount of truth that God intended for us to have. So I don't agree with this view either. Now, at this point, I'm firmly convinced that the third view is the right view. This is the view where teleos, perfect, refers strictly to mature, or better yet, the completed canon of Scripture. The completed canon of Scripture. In other words, the finished New Testament canon or writings captured by the apostles and their immediate associates completed the written word of God, and once that happened, the knowing in part and the prophesying in part in verse 9 were done away with. I think this is easily supported by the context. Just read through the context. Listen to how one commentator has said it. He said this: it is difficult to miss the antithetic parallel between the quote-unquote partial thing and the quote-unquote perfect or complete, mature, full thing. Since the partial speaks of the sporadic revelatory gifts of tongues, prophecy, and knowledge, then it would seem that the perfect, which supplants or supersedes these, represents the perfect and full New Testament Scripture. Modes of revelation are being contrasted. Knowledge, prophecy, well, what's it being contrasted with? Complete understanding of knowledge and prophecy, a doctrine, a body of Scripture, a closed canon. All he's saying is that if we stick with the context, you have to conclude that Paul is dealing with revelation, knowledge and prophecy, in their partial forms. The church in that age didn't have everything that they were supposed to have yet. Other apostles were still completing the canon. There's a second view, a second reason why I think Paul's referring to the completed canon of Scripture when he uses teleos, because of the illustration in verse 11. Look at verse 11 again. Paul says, when I was a child, I used to speak like a child, think like a child, reason like a child. Notice what he's referring to in his childhood stages. He's referring to knowledge. He's referring to information that he was able to communicate. He's referring to the thoughts that he had. All of those things were limited by his growth in this illustration. He had partial understanding, partial knowledge, limited abilities to reason. But then he goes on to say, when I became a man, I did away with childish things. Literally, childish things were abolished. Same verb that he uses to talk about the abolishing of gifts of prophecy and knowledge. When Paul became a quote-unquote full-grown man, and he moved to a state of completeness. The incomplete thoughts were gone. The incomplete knowledge was gone. Incomplete information of a child and his immaturity were gone. And all that progressed to knowledge and information as an adult. Paul's point in this analogy is this. When the church was in her infancy stages, she operated by means of bit by bit, piecemeal revelation. But when she grew older, she operated by the finalized totality, completeness of Scripture. That's what we operate by right now, right? We have all that God wants us to know right here. He's put it right before us. There's no need for more gifts of knowledge, no need for a gift of prophecy, no more need for tongues. Verse 12 adds further weight to this view. Paul says, for now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I will know fully, just as I also have been fully known. Very wordy, but this is what I think Paul means. The seeing in a mirror dimly refers to the partial, sporadic, limited revelation that we're coming through the gifts of prophecy, tongues, and knowledge. That fits the context well. The Corinthians were not at a point in redemptive history yet where they could see the full revelation of God clearly, totally. Apostles, as I've said, were still writing. Revelation was still being communicated by God through his messengers. They only saw in a mirror dimly. But once the full revelation of God was disclosed, then we would be face to face with what God had fully and finally said. Face to face, a lot of debate over this. We won't get into it. We won't have time to get into it. Face to face is a Hebrew idiom. It's not to be taken literally. It simply implies something along the lines of person to person, or better yet, how the Lord spoke to his people directly, clearly. Face-to-face simply means that the church finally will have the complete, closed canon of God's revelation that he directly communicated, that the Lord has finalized for us. And at that point, the completed canon gives the believer the capacity to know fully, which he says in that illustration, which is what Paul says, second half of verse 12. Listen to what one commentator has said. We're getting close to closing. Paul envisioned a time, yet future, when believers would have the entire realm of mystery doctrine to objectively know themselves as never before and be spiritually self-sustaining. Do we not have the ability to know ourselves as much as God wants us to know by what he's disclosed to us here? We are fully known by what the scriptures reveal about us. Only God has a complete knowledge of the believer, and only with a complete canon can the believer have sufficient objective knowledge of himself. Through learning and applying doctrine from the completed and sufficient Scripture, a mirror is constructed in this soul. This mirror of truth enables the believer to accurately and objectively evaluate his own life circumstances from the divine viewpoint. Beloved, the revelatory gifts for the early church, for the Corinthian church, were designed only to be partial. In other words, for a limited time only. And they were intended to be superseded by something that was more comprehensive of the same category. Revelation, knowledge, prophecy. In other words, the more comprehensive work was the completed canon of Scripture, the very Bible that we hold in our hands. So when the last living apostle, the Apostle John, wrote his last word in the book of Revelation, when he set his pen down, prophecy was done. Prophecy was done. The gift of the word of knowledge was done. Tongues, there's an argument for this, but I think tongues ceased well before that, simply because of the verb that Paul used, but we didn't get into that. There was no more need for them. We have the complete written words of God that he intended for us. No more need for tongues, no more need for prophecy, no more need for any of the miraculous or revelatory gifts. So hopefully that was clear, but understand and don't miss the entire point of this passage. Paul wants to make sure that the church learns how to love in light of the gifts that they do have. He wants them to know, to learn how to love, because it's love that will abide. Faith, hope, and love abide. These three, the greatest of these is love. Love will never cease. Your gifts will cease. Emphasize, prioritize love. These particular gifts, unique to the apostolic age, to some in the Corinthian church, they were on their way out. The only thing that was going to remain was love. Don't invest into what is fading, failing, falling away. Invest in love, which will last forever. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I know that there was a lot of information, and I just pray that you would use your word and your spirit to communicate and really cement in our minds just a very ambiguous topic in evangelicalism right now. So many people emphasizing the wrong thing, and yet you've charged us to emphasize and prioritize love. May our love for one another be evident, sacrificial, self-giving, self-denying, selfless. And may the gifts that you've given us, they're not minimalized, but they are used appropriately in the context of love. Help us to do that, we pray. In Christ's name, amen.